Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown.
Footsteps walking down his hall. He lived at the end of a long hall, and his door was the only door down that hall. And the footsteps would stop at his door. Then a rap would come to the door. And at midnight, we heard the footsteps coming down the hall. I said, Roger, put your hand on the doorknob and get ready to pull it open. And so with all the bravado that I could muster with a gun, I waited for the rap on the door, and there it came.
Heart Research Center presents part two of A Trip into the Supernatural with best-selling author Roger Morneau. In part one of this exclusive interview, Roger Morneau told about his experiences with Satanism as a young man. Joining him again in part two are Cyril and Cynthia Grossi, who helped Roger break away from the power of darkness to discover a loving God. Conducting this interview are Dan and Karen Houghton of Heart Research Center. Let's now watch the conclusion of A Trip into the Supernatural.
We continued, and we continued to give him Bible studies with the smoke and all. And we got down to the Bible study where health, diet and health. And
body temple.
Body temple. And he was fascinated with that. And so we finally told him that, I think there's a text that when men turn away from God, they turn to the bitter weed.
Bitter herb.
Or herb or something. So we like the bitter herb too. Tobacco and so on. He was fascinated with it. And he says, well, why didn't you tell me that you didn't smoke?
I think what really got him was the, when he read, know ye not that your body is a temple of God, and if any man defile a temple of God, him will God destroy. And so he asked me, what do you mean by that? So my reply was, well, let's take the church. We all respect the church. Would you take a cigarette into the church and smoke it? He said, of course not. Then I said, would you take alcohol into the church and drink it? He said, no, that would be silly. And so by making those comparisons, finally I said, your body is the church. Your body is the temple. He said, am I smoking? I said, right. He said, why didn't you tell me this on the first night? I said, if I had told you this on the first night, you wouldn't come the second night. He said, you know, that's right. So you can see where patience is a virtue. If you use patience and take your time, it pays off.
He told us that he realized he was getting into demon worship to the point where it was scaring him. He was frightened. And he prayed a prayer to God, even though he didn't realize it, and it wasn't with all the trappings that Christians usually use, but he said, if there is a God in heaven, help me. And at that time, you were an answer to his prayer.
That's right.
But also, wasn't he an answer to your prayer?
He certainly was. When Elder Taylor got to the point in his Bible studies of speaking about the Sabbath, all of my background, I was born in Halifax, Cynthia was born in Montreal. All of my background was Baptist and some Methodist. And I couldn't see going to church on Saturday instead of Sunday. In fact, I would laugh at my wife for quite some time, even as a child, that the fact that she was going to church on the wrong day. But getting back to the point is, when we were taking those Bible studies and Nella Taylor got to the Sabbath question, he proved it. Yet I didn't believe it. And there's a point in your studying the Word of God that you want to stay with tradition rather than go with the truth. And I wanted to stay with tradition. But at the same time, the truth was pulling me back to the point where I said, I didn't even tell Cynthia this. Lord, if you want me to keep this Sabbath, let me, with the knowledge I have, win one soul. And if I do this, I know that it will be a sign. And not long afterward, I met Roger, sat down beside him, and he asked me for Bible studies. I know it was a sign. I'm here today.
What part did Cyril's conviction about the Sabbath truth play in you being confronted by Christ with these eternal realities? So I understand that he wasn't even a baptized Seventh-day Adventist. He was baptized the first Sabbath you went to church. But what if he had not been convicted of the Sabbath and had told your Jewish boss that he would be willing to work on the Sabbath?
Well, I would lose out on eternity, I believe. I would have lost hope.
So his conviction was part of the process that Christ used to confront you.
But there's more to this. He was working for a real nice firm, embroidery firm. And he was studying the Bible with Pastor Taylor, and Pastor Taylor had brought him now to the point where he said, you should observe the seventh-day Sabbath if you're going to, you know, serve the Lord all the way. Serve the Lord, serve him all the way. The Lord says, if you love me, keep my commandments. The fourth commandment says, remember the Sabbath to keep it holy. And the Lord says, why he wants us to keep it holy? Because he's God and we're the creatures, and that we ought to be counting our blessings, so to speak. Now, Cyril was pondering this thing in his mind, and he said to himself, and he prayed about it, Lord, I want some kind of a sign that you're really with me in this, that you want me to start keeping the seventh-day Sabbath now. But Lord, there's something missing. I tell you what, if you make it possible for me to meet someone that doesn't know about the Sabbath, because not too many people know about it anyway, and that I'm able to convince him of the importance of the biblical Sabbath of creation, then he says, I'll know that you want me to start giving a Sabbath now, instead of next year or some other time. And do you know that prayer was answered in 2 weeks? We figured out a time, about a time that I said, there's a God in heaven that cares for me, help me. I think it's a couple of days after that he made a decision that, hey, Lord, show me. And I just would like to enjoy the experience of knowing that you're listening to me and that you're doing something special for me. And I'm doing something special for you because I'm obeying your commandment.
So in reality, Roger, you were an answer to his prayers. Before, while you were still a spiritist.
Mm-hmm. Cyril, did you and Cynthia know at this time when you were studying with Roger that he was involved at all with spirit worship?
You know, the Lord blessed us mightily. He blessed us with the fact that we were completely ignorant of anything. And I would not advise anybody to openly go and do something like we did with having the knowledge that this person is a devil worshiper, because no person has the power to overcome this on their own. But I feel very impressed that the Lord, the Holy Spirit, guided us, and our eyes were covered until a certain time that we could handle it.
And when was that time, Cyril? When did you discover that this man worshipped demon spirits?
We discovered that midway between the lessons. And I don't know exactly what point it was, but one night he came, and we had previously studied on the unpardonable sin. And he came with tears in his eyes, and he was very upset. And he said, he said he was upset, and he had books on his arm. And I said, well, what are you so upset about, Roger? Roger in French. And he said, well, you don't know what I've been doing. So I said, look, the Bible says all manner of sins will be forgiven. And he said, but you don't know what I've done. So after he told me what he had been doing, worshiping the devil and getting acquainted with devil worship and going very deep into it, he showed me some books. And when I opened one of the books and read some instructions on how to worship the devil, I closed it up. I said, I don't want to see this. And I said, but one thing I want to make clear. I said, if you had committed the unpardonable sin, you would not be here willing to study the Bible. And therefore, the scripture that says all manner of sins will be forgiven applies to you. I said, you must consider yourself forgiven, and you must forgive yourself. And we went on from there.
I didn't even know what a devil worshiper was. I think we were both very naive. And And so I went along, and I said, well, I tell you what, we'll leave the fact whether the sin is pardonable or unpardonable to God, and let's finish the Bible study. That was all of the information and knowledge that I had. And it wasn't until later. And then he began telling us, you know, a little bit about the troubles he was having. And I thought that was rather unusual, and we're being involved.
Now, Cyril, whenever you did learn, you and Cynthia, about this spiritism business, mm-hmm. you immediately had a question about whether or not it was real. You were really naive about that. Mm-hmm. Now, tell us, you had some special dispensation, some special work with the police department there in Canada, and you had the ability to carry a gun, is that right?
Yes, I had a permit to carry a gun. And when he told me that not only was he having these manifestations, he was also having, he heard footsteps walking down his hall. He lived at the end of a long hall, and his door was the only door down that hall. And the footsteps would stop at his door, then a rap would come to the door. And we were also having trouble with the union at that time. So when he told me about mm-hmm. these rappings on the door, I said, no, that's only those union people trying to come and get you.
Yeah.
So I said, I'll scare them away just the same as I scared them away when they came to get me. And so I had so much faith in the gun that, don't forget, I wasn't baptized at this time.
That's right.
I had faith in this gun. So I took my gun and we went to Rote's place. And we were laughing and talking and just having a jolly time. And at midnight, we heard the footsteps coming down the hall. I said, Roger, put your hand on the doorknob and get ready to pull it open. And so with all the bravado that I could muster with a gun, I waited for the rap on the door, and there it came. And I don't know exactly how many times the rap came.
Well, first you opened the door, and there was nobody there.
Right.
And you said, now his color changed. The color of his face changed.
The color of his
oh,
face
yes,
changed?
Yeah,
believe it or not.
He wasn't expecting union people.
Yeah, there wasn't anybody there.
There was nobody there.
What was your emotion at that moment, Sarah? What did you when that door came open?
And there was nothing there.
Well, his emotion, excuse me for jumping in here,
okay.
was that he was almost like a statue of salt.
That was your observation,
yeah.
Roger.
That's right. So I said, hey, let's sit down, man. I said, you know, they're not going to harm us. So we sat down with Cyril, mm-hmm. and we talked some more. There was no problem. And about 10 minutes later, the spirit knocked on my balcony door. And the glass was loose a little bit in there, and it rattled pretty bad.
And did he still have all the bravado?
By then, he jumped right out of his seat. Didn't you, Cyril? And he said, let's get out of here, you know, because he knocked real hard.
Yeah. It was at that time I said, Roger, I think it's time for me to get rid of the gun. And get baptized.
Yeah, that's right. That made him make his decision to be baptized.
Well, I've heard of lots of ways the decisions are made, but that's probably one of the most unique I've heard, Cyril.
Dramatic, to say the least.
Yes.
We were like children dealing with something we had no knowledge about, and he protected us. And like I said, if anyone knows of someone who is involved in this, they can't do it alone.
Requires special prayer and protection,
and it requires the Lord to be the one to handle the situation. A man cannot handle the situation because the powers and principles that involved in this, no man can withstand.
What gave you the sense that you now had an opportunity for salvation? What was it that told you had a chance?
Well, the Holy Spirit was inspiring me. The Holy Spirit was ministering to me the grace of redemption. And to be able to put it into words, I don't have this kind of a vocabulary, because it's a mystery type thing. The Holy Spirit recreates you as He ministers to you, you see? And cleans your mind and gives you understanding and you see things in different light that you never thought about before. Life becomes a meaningful thing all of a sudden, and you'd be waiting to die for it, you see, for what you've learned, because that's what I said to myself. The second night when I went back home, I had about an hour in the streetcar to my place. I got home at 12 o'clock. I said, hey, they do me in tonight. And when I have the beautiful experience of having learned these great, wonderful things about God. Beautiful things. So on Wednesday night, there I had the first hope. I can't remember exactly what verse of scripture was, but this one here says, "He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God." You see, and you had to explain what it meant.
And you took that right into your heart.
Yeah.
Roger, during these 3 days, from Monday night, Tuesday night, to Wednesday night, what went through your mind regarding the spirits?
I knew that I was going to be worked over by the spirits, either through one of their boys or some accident or something, see. This is the way I felt, I mean. And I said, this is very unusual that nothing has happened yet. And I'm going home on Wednesday night again with another appointment for Thursday Bible study at 7 o'clock.
Now, let me make sure I understand. You had missed Wednesday night's spirit praise service. At which time you were supposed to have made your full commitment.
Yeah, would have.
And you had been at a Bible study instead.
That is correct. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what happened next?
So I said, this will be the end of it. Wednesday night, I said, they'll have a praise session to the gods, and that'll be it. But nothing happens Wednesday night. Thursday morning, I was alive. And I went back for another Bible study, and that is four more. And by then, I realized that the Creator was taking care of things. Because these people never give God the glory, but they always refer to higher powers. They respect, they pride themselves on the fact that they respect authority, you see. So therefore, they recognize the Creator for who He is. But of course, that the Master, fallen Lucifer, is just as smart as God is. And he's got it worked out, so he's going to have a kingdom to himself for eternity, and you know, you don't have to worry about things. So I realized that the power of God was intervening. Now I became a brave, see? And the Spirit of God gave me the strength to do that. Because I said that God gave me the strength to be able to die for these things that I just learned, see? And that's what happened. I got those Bible studies.
So you went ahead and went to Bible studies on Friday night?
Yeah.
And then you kept your first Sabbath.
Oh, yeah.
Didn't you? Tell us about your experience on Sabbath.
First, that evening, before I left, 11 o'clock, Cyril says, you enjoy the Bible studies? Oh, yeah, very, very much so. I said, tomorrow you people are going to church. He says, yeah. I said, interesting. He said, would you like to come with us? I said, yeah. Because I had the Bible study on the Sabbath already. I said, sure. I'm still alive. And he said, what do you mean by you're still alive? Well, I said, you know, I said, if I'm still alive, I'll be here, I'll do this, I'll do that. But I knew what I'd said, I'm still alive. And he said, would you join us here and we'll walk to church? It's not that far, we'll walk a few blocks and it'll be a nice day tomorrow. I said, yeah, sure, I'll meet you here. And we walked to church, and we were welcome at the door, and there was a rack of brochures on the walls. I walked over and looked at some of them, picked up a couple, put in my pocket, and we were from Sabbath school, and I thought it was great.
Roger, the Lord helped you get through the Sabbath day without smoking. How did you eventually deal with your smoking habit?
Well, I tell you, Pastor Taylor talked, for quite a while, when it got to be about 7:15 in the evening, I was getting very distressed because I got a tremendous urge of smoking about an hour before. And I said, oh, I gotta have a cigarette. I just can't stand it anymore. And as the pastor continued explaining what I had to ask him to explain, it was difficult for me. And as you left, I told Cyril and Cindy, I said, I'm sorry, but I got to smoke. And on the way home, the streetcar, I said to myself, this is going to be, she was expression, but hell on earth to give up smoking. Then I said, no, it's not going to be. because I'm going to have help. I got to my apartment and I opened a closed closet and I had two cartons of cigarettes on the shelf. And I opened them up and threw all the cigarettes, you know, all the packs were opened up, threw into the toilet and flushed it down the drain. And then I knelt by the little table I had there with my Bible on it. And I had that already had started to read that Crucifixion of Christ, which I have read for 45 years now, every morning. Matthew, the 27th chapter, verses 24 through 54. Every day, God willing, I always read it. Well, now I can have my devotions at night and I don't have to put the light on because I know it by heart, see? Mm-hmm. But there I placed my trust and my life in the care of the Lord of Glory, who had shed his precious blood on Calvary to acquire the legal right to be able to redeem me from where I was and from where I was going. So that was the end of smoking. Never had a desire to smoke again. Mm-hmm. I told him to take the desire away to recreate me. I realized that he was a creator, he can recreate.
Rogers, you came closer to making a full commitment to God. Did the demons try to prevent you from making that commitment in any way?
Well, I didn't have to wait too long. During the week, the Spirit of God held back the demon spirit so that he could not have access to me. I realized that from Wednesday night on. Then, as I came home at midnight of that Saturday night, there was a note on my door from my buddy. And he said, "It is urgent that I talk to you tonight. I don't care if you call me in the middle of the night." But he says, "I got to talk to you. We're having a terrible disaster. Facing a terrible disaster." So I said, "Well, Roland, must have gotten some real static, you know." Sure enough. First of all, I wanted to review something that we'd studied at night. So I had a book. They lent me a book, St. John Searle, and I opened the book up and I started to read. And there was a marker, a sheet of paper actually, that had been cut in half in there. And I had put it on the table. And the piece of paper started to levitate and move around the room. See? So it didn't bother me. I knew. What was doing it. And then the sheet of paper came and stood about a foot above my book. Then it was slapped down on the book, and the book fell on my lap, and almost into the floor I picked it up. See? And I felt like telling the spirits, you know, buzz off. But I had understood that I would not again talk with spirits. I had made up my mind on that. So I pick up the book again, started to write, and then the spirit picked up the book and threw it across the room against the wall with tremendous force. So I decided, well, I'm going to go and phone my buddy, see what he's going to do. Now, there was a public phone in the hallway. I didn't want to use it. I went down to a diner or restaurant or just down the block, and I called him up. "How's things rolling?" He says, "Man," he says, "Oh," he said, "don't you care for my life, Morneau? What kind of a friend are you? I've been suffering," he says, "since Wednesday," he says, "trying to get a hold of you. And," he says, "I've been waiting at your door. What time did you come home?" I said, "Come home at midnight. He said, "You're in real trouble. Because the high priest, as a spirit, appeared to him on Wednesday evening and told him that you were studying the Bible with some Christians, but you were not just studying the Bible with Christians, you were studying the Bible with Seventh-day Adventists, the people that the Master hates most on the face of the planet. How in the world did you get yourself involved in something like that? Don't you care for your life?" I said, "Sure. Beside that," he says, and he told me other things that the spirits had told, the high priest. So it went, the conversation went on the phone for a while, and I said, now listen, it's not possible for me to explain to you over the phone what has taken place in my studying the Bible 4 hours per evening, you know, through the week. Why don't you come to see me tomorrow sometime, and I'll give you the reasons, the real reasons why I did what I did. He said, okay. So we made an appointment for sometime Monday, Sunday morning. And I went back after my phone call, I went back to my apartment. And then I decided I might as well get to bed slight. I get to bed. I was not sooner in bed that the lights went on. I got up, went through the lights off. Get back to bed, the light goes on again. I said to myself, there's no use getting up, turning the lights off. They're going to put them back on again. So I'm going to decide to go to sleep with the lights on. So after a while, things start moving around the place. A picture on that wall goes and sticks itself on the wall. There's no nothing to hold it up. And the light that was on the table moved and stayed in midair. It stays there. See?
Were you feeling afraid at this time?
Oh, no, not at all. No.
No,
because of the fact that, you see, you get, human beings get accustomed to a lot of things. And you get supernatural strength, either from good or evil. Mm-hmm. And the Lord was singing me through this thing. And I knew that I was going to have a terrible struggle somewhere along the way, somehow. And they were going to try to destroy me, no question about it. So after this nonsense had gone quite a while, I went on to sleep. Hey, I'm going to get my rest. I'm tired. I said, Lord, you know, bless the old guy. I was not old in those days, though. But I said, bless the fellows. I can get some rest from these spirits. And I went to sleep. And it woke me up about 2 o'clock in the morning again. And at 4 o'clock, at 4 o'clock in the morning there, I sat up in bed, pushed my pillow in the back, and I said to myself, what in the world am I going to do? Because the Lord doesn't clear the mouth from me. Then I got a thought that maybe the Lord just wants me to know from the spirits exactly how things are, how I'm standing with them. And I said to the spirit, you want to talk to me? The spirit said, yes, finally, I'm able to talk to you. What in the world do you think you're doing? You see, the Lord had held back even on the spirits, that the spirits could not talk to me. I realized that they were under a very special control. So I got to talk with the spirit, and I realized that he was a spirit counselor, because he said, the master has tremendous plans for your life. Fame, honor, respect, wealth. Don't you value any of these things? I said, I want you to know, Spirit, that 10 days ago, I would have grabbed your offer. But now you're talking to a former spirit worshiper, and I'm educated to the reality of life, especially of the reality of eternal life. And I said, I'm not interested. For about maybe 2 or 3 minutes, maybe 4 minutes, and it's a long time, in a conversation there was no response to what I had said.
It was like he was totally amazed by your courage.
Yeah. Then when the spirit spoke again, he had a tremor in his voice. In other words, you know when a person gets really desperate in a crisis situation, your voice changes. And it gave me the impression that he had a hard time expressing himself. And that was a very clever individual. Well, he said, we've worked for so long over the years to prepare you for the master's work. And what are you doing? You know, and things like that. And he told me, okay, you're turning down the offer of the master. I said, definitely. He said, from now on, he says, poverty would be the lot of your life. That is, he says, if you can manage to stay alive. And he says, that, I doubt that you weren't going to have much of. He says, your days are numbered. I said, you know, Spirit, the high priest has mentioned about higher powers. Am I affiliated now with higher powers? And I said, I don't have to concern myself with you or your master or any of the other spirits, because you're all losers. I am the winner. 100 million years of perfect life, recreated, translated, or resurrected body that I'll have. My years will be counted into the millions of years. If I take the offer of the master, what do I have? I'm 20 years of age. Add, even if I live to be 100, how can you compare that to 100 million years? And I'll have all the gold that I want and the silver that you're offering me, and more. So I'm not a loser no more. I'm a winner. And the spirit says, will destroy you. And he laughed. He had this was frightening. For one time, he had this laugh that caused me to think immediately of the laugh that Nero, instantly, Nero must have had on his face when the lions were tearing the Christians apart. That's the thing. I said, this is the way that Nero must have laughed when the lions were tearing Christians apart, you know, in the arena of the Colosseum in Rome. Yeah.
So how did the spirit finally leave, Roger?
They finally leave, almost took the door away with him. He left through the balcony door, and the door was slammed open. Yeah, open. And the doorknob almost went through the plaster in the wall.
Did he leave on his own accord?
I commanded him to. I commanded him in the name of the Lord Jesus to leave my place, come no more.
And he left?
And he left. And instead of slamming the door shut behind him, like a person would, he slammed the door open as he went out, and it slammed into the wall. And the doorknob, Cyril may still remember, you could see the imprint of the doorknob in the plaster. Of the house was maybe 50 years old, so the plaster had been settled a long time.
You commanded the demon to leave by the blood of Jesus Christ.
Yep.
He left, slammed the door. Did you go back to sleep?
Yeah.
And then the next morning, your friend Roland came over.
Well, between that, I'd like to tell you a little bit more. I woke up in the morning, of course, and I said, my, time to get up. And my Bible, my night table was to my left. As I was laying in bed, I put my hand on the Bible, and then I started to shuffle, you know, the pages like this. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking about many things, and I was doing this. And all of a sudden, I opened the Bible, wide open. And then I got thinking about it again, never realizing what I had done. I got up, and after I stretched myself out a little bit, I look at the Bible, and my eyes fell on this Isaiah chapter by Isaiah, the prophet, and I got reading, and it was the experience of Ezekiah when Sennacherib, the great general of the armies of the Assyrians, had compassed about the city of Jerusalem, and he was telling Ezekiah that he might as well give up, open the gates, you know, you're not going to survive this because we've destroyed all the nations that we've gone through before getting here. And I was very impressed. The fact that Ezekiah took the letter that the general had sent him, and he went in the temple of the Lord and placed it before the Lord, and he talked to the Lord about the letter. You see? And asked for his protecting care and guidance. And when he had not yet returned to his castle, when Isaiah came, the prophet, and he told, he says, the Lord has got a message for you. The way that Sennacherib has come, that's the way that he's going to return. And I love that prayer. That is the kind of prayer. Memorize that. It was a beautiful prayer.
Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the weak
He which testifieth these things saith, Surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus.